Press the bell icon on YouTube and don't miss another update.
Do you know how India's national security is organized and led at the very top? Remember, India is a country of 1.34 billion people, nuclear weapons, fourth largest armed forces in the world, many threats along its borders and many threats within as well. It's a multi-layered system. Of course, Prime Minister is the chief executive. Prime Minister has a national security advisor whose role is advisory, who tells the Prime Minister what the facts are, coordinates between various agencies, a key top position. And then there is the most important committee of the cabinet called Cabinet Committee on Security, which is presided over by the Prime Minister, but essentially has the ministers of home, external affairs, defense, and finance ministries in it. Then there are many other structures in various ministries and think tanks, etc., which give their inputs, all of which come to the Cabinet Committee on Security, on whose advice the Prime Minister decides. Of course, Prime Minister has the final word. Now, much of this has changed radically with one notification issued not by the Cabinet Secretariat or by the Prime Minister's office, but issued by the National Security Council Secretariat. And what does this say? This says that a new look SPG, not the SPG that you see protecting the Prime Minister and President, but Strategic Policy Group. There was one set up by Mr. Vajpayee in 1999, but this is the new look SPG. The one that Mr. Vajpayee set up in 1999 was led by the Cabinet Secretary, at which National Security Advisor and Deputy Chairman of Planning Commission were among special invitees. Now this committee will be headed by the National Security Advisor himself. Importantly, this committee will also have the Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretariat is where, these are all nuances, where RAW, our External Intelligence Agency, is located. In fact, its budget also is subsumed in the Cabinet Secretariat's budget. So this committee then will meet occasionally to review India's security threats or security prospects. It will include, besides the three chiefs of armed forces and the chiefs of intelligence bureau and RAW, which is the two premier intelligence organizations, secretaries home for internal security, finance, because a lot of the security is now linked to the flow of global finance, secretary defense production as well, and secretary revenue in the finance ministry. Secretary revenue, remember, is the officer, top officer to whom financial intelligence agencies report, including Enforcement Directorate, Financial Intelligence Unit, Serious Frauds Investigation Office. These are all internal financial security responsibilities. Then, interestingly, this also includes Vice Chairman of Niti Aayog, which is what used to be the Planning Commission earlier, and Governor Reserve Bank of India, who has usually an exalted status where he deals directly with the finance minister. Now, this is not an issue so much of protocol or who's senior, who's junior. Those things keep happening in the government, and we don't particularly care which service leads what, IAS, IPS, IFS, it doesn't matter. The important thing here is the very system of decision making on higher security issues has now been changed. For the first time since the early 60s, India has one national security czar. Everybody inputs into him. And in this case, he has a formal secretariat, which then issues instructions or which takes decisions, which the cabinet secretary, who's usually supposed to carry out, make sure that cabinet's decisions are implemented, then has to make sure that this group's decisions are implemented not just by the central government ministries but also by the state governments. This is why we call this a radical change. This is the empowerment of one individual, whoever that individual, Mr. Doval, who has the job right now, is one of our sharpest intelligence people. But the question is, should one man, however brilliant, have all this power in a country and a system and a situation as complex as ours? Ours was the system so far of checks and balances. Why did I say this takes us back to early 60s? Because in early 60s, India had similarly an intelligence czar. His name was B.N. Malik. That is when there was only one intelligence agency, intelligence bureau. We say 62 war took place because of an intelligence failure. There was no intelligence failure. All the intelligence was there that the Chinese were preparing for war. The failure was of people assessing that intelligence. And who was assessing that intelligence? The same officer whose people were bringing that intelligence. So in the business of intelligence, higher security, you need an oversight. You need people arguing. You also need checks and balances. And later, as Mrs. Gandhi, Lal Bahadur Shastri, and then Mrs. Gandhi realized what had gone wrong, they decided to set up a second agency, which was RAW. So RAW actually came into being as a result of the fact that until 62 and 65 war also, we had only one agency, and that did not serve India well. Now you are turning the clock back on that. You are going back effectively to a one man, one agency, to a multiple agency, but led by one man situation. This can have many consequences. I'm not yet willing to say this will have negative consequences only. Let's leave that to people who are more knowledgeable and more prescient. But certainly, this is a very major change. And certainly, it's change that conservative people like me would feel concerned about.